Welcome to this episode of ComSpeak. Our guest today is Atul Sharma, one of our only guests probably who wears two hats. All the others we've had is either the head of corporate communications or the CEO or founder of a PR firm. Atul Sharma is the CEO of Rudolphine in India. He also is the president of the Public Relations Consultants Association of India, known as PRCI in short. Thank you for joining us, Atul, and we look forward to this interactive session with you.
Thank you, Amit, for having me over. It's always a pleasure to interact with you.
That's kind of you. We'll go ahead and ask you the question we ask all our guests on the show. Tell us about how you got into public relations.
Well, it's an interesting story. Around two decades back, when I walked out of my master's degree, it was the year of 2000, it wasn't one of those really nice years from a placement perspective. We were in a bit of a recession, and there weren't many firms which had come into the campus for placements. And, I did my master's in business economics, I just decided to try my luck and met up with acquaintances who are new across a public relations firm, across a market research firm, and in an advertising firm. And interestingly, around the same time, all three offers were in front of me. And I was in a bit of a dilemma and didn't know which one to choose. But I think, when I look at my decision back then, I think it was backed by a very, very strong logic that the guy who I met in the public relations firm seemed like a person who would be genuinely interested in my growth, seemed like a person who was much more, who was just much more than a boss or a supervisor. He was genuinely interested in making sure that I succeed or I learn something in my professional career. So that was then. I took that decision and joined PR Public Relations, which was known as the world's best little communication consultancy then. And I think I had a lovely journey with them that time.
Interesting. And it's been 21 years now. Tell us about your journey after that. So what happened after CLIA PR? Where did you move to? How did that happen? Tell us more about that.
Well, like any other young professional, the idea was to make sure that, you make quick money, you do some interesting work and you move every 2 years. So I think the first 2 years I did that. So the first two jobs were in quick succession. So I worked in CLIA for around 2.5 years. Then I moved to Weber Shandwick, wherein I again worked for another 2.5 years. And that's when I joined Genesys. And I think Genesys was where probably I stuck and I worked the longest. I enjoyed thoroughly every stint that I did at Genesys, whether it was in the form of a senior consulting associate or a partner or a India practice chair or the chief operating officer. I think it was a very fulfilling journey. And from there, now I'm at Rudolphine, managing Rudolphine India. And it has been definitely an interesting journey.
Absolutely. You've been in 4 companies, CLIA, Weber Shandwick, Genesys, which got renamed a couple of times from Genesys Burson Master to Genesys BCW. And now you're at Rudolphine India. I mean, an interesting journey that is. And I've seen that journey from close quarters at 2 levels earlier when we were colleagues at Genesys when you just joined. And then later on now in the last few years when I'm in Gurgaon where you are based as well. And that's really fascinating. Tell us about what are your challenges as the CEO of a global firm focused on a couple of practices in a big way. What are your challenges as the managing director in India?
So I think Rudolphine has had a very, a very, very different journey in India. So unlike globally, where we are one of the largest independent communication firms with a very, very clear focus on healthcare and technology, I think in India, we were seen as a boutique agency till some time back. So I think first, we wanted to make sure that we're seen as a serious contender in this space. And I think the last 2 years have been a journey in that direction. We've built a very strong technology and a very strong consumer practice. And now we're on the cusp of building our corporate practice and making sure that we have a strong digital play in the scheme of things. So I think that my challenges aren't any different from any other firm, but I think as a learning curve, every firm has a very, very different play. So we are in the middle of that, and that's where we are.
Interesting. I'm going to come back to some questions on this part of your journey as the head of a PR firm, but I'm going to spend a few moments talking about campaigns, because the mainstay of public relations is campaigns. And for the people who watch this show, there's something they need to take back and learn beyond just knowing the life story of a person on the show. So I'll ask you a couple of questions on campaigns. First, tell us about a communication campaign that you wish you had worked on, a campaign that you didn't work on directly. It could have been in the firm you worked at or somewhere else. But a campaign that stands out for you and you say, wow, this is the PR campaign anybody who's interested in PR should read about, learn about, and then take back as an insightful way of knowing more about PR. So tell us one campaign like that that you did not work on. I'll come to something that you worked on later.
So I think in my view, anything or any campaign that makes this world a better place is the kind of campaign that I would want to work on. And if I look around me right now, and I think, it's won many awards, the Vix Touch of Care campaign. I think the kind of issues that they touch upon, the kind of difference that they will make to people when this campaign, delivers an impact, I think that's huge. And I would love to work on this particular campaign if ever I get a chance to do that.
Nice to know. And tell us about the campaigns you worked on in a 20-year history in 4 companies. Pick up one campaign, and if you really can't, and 2 is fine, but not more than that. But pick up one campaign that you feel completely proud of, and it's the most memorable campaign you've worked on in your 20-year career in PR.
Well, I, to be very honest, there, like you rightly said, you can't differentiate between your children. So it's very, very difficult to make that choice. Right. But I think, for me, I think what I found the most fulfilling are, a few years back, I'd started a startup vertical at Genesis. And I think for me, working with the big corporates and then from there working with passionate entrepreneurs who had that passion, zeal, enthusiasm about their business idea. And I think that was where I think I did some of my most interesting work, because they were just not interested in getting front page stories. They wanted to know from you, what do I think about their business idea, and how is it that they could get their clients, their customers. And I think there are many campaigns which didn't do really well because the businesses pivoted or the funds went dry, but there were some which did exceedingly well, and I think I'm really, really proud of those campaigns. So we built, like, whether it was Make My Trip that time around or whether it was Indigo, wherein it started from scratch, or there was Hopper, which possibly pivoted and, things changed. I think it's not important what didn't succeed or succeed. I think it was about the fact that there was a camaraderie. There was genuine respect for between the client and the, public relations firm for each other. And that, in my estimation, I valued the most and I loved the most.
So Atul, tell us about one campaign that stands out for you in your 20-year career. It can be in any job you had, but that one campaign that you feel proud of that people can go and learn and read about and say, wow, this is public relations in its true sense. Tell us about that.
So I out of the 20 years that I've worked, 19 years I've spent on the technology space. So most of the campaigns that I have worked upon come from the technology realm. So this is a campaign which goes back almost a decade back. This was when, possibly laptops were at their prime best, and, people used to talk more about laptops than anything else. And one of the big laptop majors, HP, came out with this campaign called Computer is Personal Again. And right from there, I think every company today speaks about the fact that how your phone is an extension of your life, or your, iPods, or the, for that matter, any technology gadget is an extension of your life. But I think the fact that we were the creators of that campaign, the very first campaign, which spoke about technology gadgets being an extension of you and your PCs becoming personal, I think that's the campaign for me which stands out, because somewhere down the line, I think, we see that campaign in every possible technology campaign in today's day and age.
Interesting. So thanks for sharing that. So I'm sure people watching this show can go and check out the Computer is Personal Again and read more about it in your leisure time as well. I'm going to ask you one last question on your current job and then move to a couple of other things, your current day job. Tell us your vision for Rudolphin India in the next 3 to 4 years. What is your vision for this interesting global firm that you run in India?
Well, I think, like any other business leader, we want the business to succeed. We want the business to be, to be really doing well. But I think for me, the most fulfilling part of this journey will be if at Rudolphin we are able to leverage technology and disrupt the world of communication. So whether it is voice today, whether it is predictive analytics tomorrow, whether it is artificial intelligence or machine learning day after, I think the intent will be to create the most interesting, most creative work always. And that, for me, I think, is what I vision for Rudolphin. Rudolphin will be a place always where we do the most interesting work. We have clients who are happy. And we have people who are enjoying what they do and have fulfilling careers. I think that's, for me, the vision for Rudolphin.
Oh, thanks. That's good to know. I'm now going to talk to you about the other hat you wear. You are the president of PRCAI, the Public Relations Consultants Association of India. So a couple of questions on the PRCAI. What is your vision for your role as the president of PRCAI in the next few months and the next year or so? Tell us about that. And then I'll come to the next question after I hear you on the PRCAI vision you have for the next year, year and a half.
So I think PRCAI in the past few years, I think we've made some really good progress thanks to my predecessor. I think we have a very strong foundation in place. But if you ask my vision for PRCAI, I want PRCAI to be India's largest and most influential PR association. I want to be known for our professionalism. I want to be known for our ethics. And I want to be known for the fact that we are a prosperous industry. I think those three things stand out for me very clearly: prosperous, right, ethical, and professional. Those are the three clear values that we would want to, push when it comes to PRCAI. How do I intend to do that? I think professionally, if you ask me, talent happens to be one of our biggest areas to focus on. So how can we make sure that we are reskilling our talent, we are upskilling our talent, to make sure that we are seen as the most professional in our space? So there are some initiatives that we are already taking in that space. So that's one which we are already doing. Ethical, I think, it's often said, does PR need PR? But I think I very strongly believe that, PR is often misunderstood. And I think for me, PR is something which has to be true to its character as well as its purpose. And anything out there, when you're doing storytelling with the right intent and with the right purpose, I think it will always define, the way things happen in the future and for good. So yes, I think that's what we want to focus our energies on, to make sure that we are seen as an ethical association as well as an ethical industry. Last, I think for me, it is very, very important to be prosperous. We definitely see that in the past 5 years, there's definitely a resounding yes from the corporates, from the government, from various stakeholders on the role of PR. And we want more and more, young professionals to come into the space. We want more and more entrepreneurs to come into the space and, launch more firms, launch more services, and make this a much more vibrant and much more interesting community than it is. So that's what we have set out to do at our end. And I'm quite convinced that we will be able to do, to come out good with that.
Right. No, thanks for that. That's helpful to learn about and know. I'm going to ask you another question linked to your PRCAI role, but linked to also your being a leader of a PR firm. Where do you see the public relations profession evolving into 5 years from now? Say we are in 2021. How do you see the PR profession? It's changed. It's had multiple evolutions. In 2000, when you joined, 2005, 10, 15, 20, every 5 years, the profession in any field keeps changing. So how do you see the PR profession evolving 5 years from today?
Well, Amit, I don't know whether I'm a crystal ball gazer or, whether I can predict that really well. But I think one of the changes which I definitely see is the fact that I think we are much more vibrant as a community now. We have much more heterogeneous talent than we used to have earlier. We have people from the realm of, you know, advertising, influencer space, media planning space, advocacy, you know, joining the forces at public relations. And I definitely feel that public relations firms in the next 5 years are going to be a much more, you know, vibrant lot. They will also, I think, redefine their character in a big way. So I definitely see that right from design thinking to doing some great work in the social and digital space to looking at campaigns in the, you know, from an advocacy perspective or from policy communications perspective, I think this industry is going to change in a big, big way. And I think for a lot of us who are possibly sitting, you know, cushy in their spaces and are not evolving as this, you know, as this industry evolves, I think we will be left with nothing to do. So I think there's a lot of change coming our way. I think in the last 1.5 years, we've seen that that you could be forced to go through some changes, and you can always come out stronger as long as there is a will to go through that change. And I think that's going to define the future of public relations.
Interesting. I'm glad you use terms like design thinking and policy communications and advocacy. Those are words we hear once in a while, but they're not commonly used in conversations like these. Again, for people watching the show, look up design thinking, look up policy communications and advocacy, and learn more about these emerging facets of public relations as a whole. I'm going to move now from the professional to the personal. A couple of personal questions to you. One is, I know for a fact that you grew up in Himachal Pradesh. Tell us about your growing up years. How was it growing up in a place near Shimla? How was it going to school there? Tell us about that. And now you work in the hustle and bustle of NCR. So tell us about your growing up years in the 80s and 90s.
So I think it was very different. It was, I can, you know, there's a world of difference between these two worlds. And I think still, whenever I go back, I'm sure you'll empathize with that every time you go back to Bangalore, that there's a whole different world out there. You know, I think the pace is very different, and I think, you know, somewhere down the line, you tend to appreciate a lot more things than what you do in the hustle and bustle of these big cities. And I think one of the reasons why I love this profession is, when I was growing up, I spent a lot of time with my grandparents, and they used to love to tell stories. And, you know, there was always, you know, every time we would finish our dinner and you would sit down, all the grandchildren would be sitting in front of, you know, our grandfather, and he would narrate stories for hours and hours. And I think that magic of that storytelling, I think it has continued with me so far. And somewhere down the line, I think it's helped me, you know, to do more for this profession than possibly I would have anyways done. Yes, that's about my childhood. There are many facets, but, you know, I could go on and on about that.
No, fascinating though. It's always good to live some part of your life with your grandparents, learn from them, get to know more about their stories, their lives. Absolutely. What do you do to unwind? You have a busy life. You wear two hats. You have a family in Gurgaon. How do you spend leisure time? What do you do to unwind beyond work?
Well, I think, you know, like you asked me a question about the fact that how did I grow up? I think my growing up has a lot to do with the way that I'm as a person. So I think I never wind up so hard that I have to unwind. I think that's the way I look at myself. So, you know, I think my purpose in life, if you ask me, is more about making sure that people are happy around me, what they do, whether it's my family, whether it is my work, whether it's my clients. I think, you know, you attract negativity, you get more of it. You attract happiness and you spread happiness, you can get more of it. I think that's the way I believe and I think. But I think to come to specifically your question, because I'm sure that you will again ask me this question if I don't answer this.
Absolutely.
I do a lot of things. I run, I meditate, I jog, I do yoga. I used to go to the gym at one point in time. Hopefully, very soon, might be able to go again. I read. I do I spend time with my children. I play with my dog. I spend some really good time with my wife. And I think that just makes sure that I'm happy as a person always. And I'm able to spread that happiness further.
Well, thanks for sharing that. We have the last question of this first part of the interview, and then we'll move to the rapid fire, which will be a few questions to be answered in a few seconds. The last question is, if there were two messages you were to leave behind for younger professionals, people in their 20s getting into the public relations space, what would that message from you be? We'd love to hear from you on your message for the younger people getting into PR.
I think for the young ones, I'll make it two messages, but my only one message to them is about the fact that, you know, it's a ever-evolving space. I think the learning never ceases to be. Just the way I think if you were a doctor and after 1 year, you would go back, you would study to make sure that you are completely up to date with your profession. I think that's the way you need to treat this profession, because if you want to stay ahead, if you want to make sure that you're unique, you're differentiated in the way what you bring to the table, I think invest in yourself and keep on investing in yourself on an ongoing basis. So never, ever stop to learn. I think that's one thing which I would tell the young professional. Yes, they have a lot to do. Unlike us who started possibly 20 years back, wherein we used to have possibly a 9-to-9 work day. Now it's a 24-hour work day. So they have a lot to do. But I think this is something which will always keep them ahead in their professional journey. The second piece which I would tell them is that, you know, your learning is completely your responsibility. Often we tend to go into jobs and tend to blame our supervisors, tend to blame the organization, or tend to blame our clients for what we don't end up learning. But I think, you know, if we just took responsibility for our own learning, I think as a professional, you would do way, way, way better. And I think that's my only advice that I will give to the young professionals of today, that stay invested in yourself and make sure that you're always surging ahead of the curve.
Thank you so much. That's helpful. I'm going to go back to the first response you gave me for our first question when we began this interview. You said there was that one gentleman or one person, I think it's a man, who became like a sponsor to you, not just a boss, but you felt he genuinely cared for your growth and progress. If you want to share the name of that person, you can, because it'll help people gain more inspiration. I wanted to ask you that then. I said I'll keep it for the end. But if you feel you don't want to, we can.
Definitely. I think,
wait to hear that name in your biography someday.
I think definitely I would be more than happy to talk about my mentor. He's Nikhil Day. He's, you know, he's the executive director at AdFactors these days. Right. And I think, you know, right from the fact that he was genuinely interested in making me learn things and he just didn't want to get the work done. I think that's where, you know, you can, that's where the divide comes in. Right from, you know, client servicing to new business development to, you know, something as basic as join small things, you know, like the way we possibly write a press release, how could you make it different? The way you would do a slide, how could you make it different? I think, you know, finding real joy in small things in a profession, I think that's what keeps you going. That's what keeps you, in your professional journey. And Absolutely. Yes, let me do that.
No, I guess it was Nikhil. I didn't want to assume. So I said, let me ask you and hear it from you. Because I remember still I had joined Genesis a month before Nikhil and 4 or 5 months before you. And when you were joining the firm, I still remember him telling a bunch of us, saying, "This is a very young, smart guy I'm hiring. I worked with him previously. And he'll be a great leader for the tech practice we are rebuilding in the firm in Delhi." And I remember you joining sometime in 2004 or 5 and your initial days in the firm. And good to know that the person
those were really nice days. I definitely.
Yes, we didn't have Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn to while away time with that time. There was Orkut in a small way, but we didn't go into Orkut in the work hours. And I still remember those days were really fun and interesting. Absolutely. And because you mentioned the word of a mentor or more than a mentor, I read a very interesting Harvard article 2 days ago, and I thought I should bring it up here, of how there are three concepts. There's a coach, there's a mentor, and there's a sponsor. And these three are all different in their own ways. A mentor just mentors you. A sponsor does much more than that, and a coach does something else altogether. And I'm saying this here because young people watching the show and others too should look up sponsorship, mentorship, and coaching. separately and see how you can find your own mentor, sponsor, coach in the future. And this is not sponsor or sponsoring an event or sponsoring something. It's not a money sponsor. It's a human sponsoring another human by really investing in them and making them thrive in the mid to long term as well. Absolutely. So thanks so much, Atul. It was great talking to you in the last few minutes and hearing these stories from you. Before we wind up, I'll ask you to spare a few minutes. You have about 20 seconds per answer. So less than 200 seconds to answer 9 to 10 questions. We'll do this rapid fire right away. Let's start. What's the brand you trust the most?
I would say Toyota.
Toyota, wow. Because I rarely get an automobile brand in these interviews. What is your favorite book? One book that you really hold dear?
Well, this is a difficult one because I could... But I think if I had to really, really pick one book, there's a very interesting book called Jonathan Livingston Seagull by Richard Bach. I think it's a very, very thin book, but something which really has evolved me as a person. I think that's one book I would always pick.
The best company you've worked for so far in your 20-year career? No diplomatic answers here.
Well, it's not a diplomatic answer, but I think every company has given me something unique.
One company. Pick up one company.
No, I definitely think that today,
go on. I just did a timer for fun.
Okay.
You did it's a timer. It's a rapid fire.
No, I agree. No, I think if I had to choose one company, I definitely feel that, Genesis and not Genesis BCW was the company which
Fair I enough. No, that's it. I hear you and I know where you're coming from. And I respect that. Absolutely. What is the one boss of yours that you always will think highly of? Name that one boss. It could be a boss, super boss that stands out for you in your career of 20 years.
I think for me, Nikhil's been a boss, but I think he's been more than a boss. For me, Prema would be that person because I think right from, not only clients.
It's a rapid fire. Just the name is fine. It's Prema Sagar and we absolutely like that answer. Name one professional role model for you. It can be an Indian, global person, worked for, not worked for. A role model that you see in the profession at large.
I think for me, it has to be somebody like a Satya Nadella, because I think, like I said, it is more to do with his journey, his, the core value that he holds, which is empathy. And and he's a successful CEO at the end of the day. So, yes,
absolutely.
Definitely one of the most.
Name one Indian communicator that you admire.
I would say Nikhil Day, definitely. I look up to him for his strategic vision in the communication space. So, yes.
Fair enough. Name one comms campaign that you thought highly of but did not work out in the end. It did not work out. It just fell flat. I mean, it's just from a retrospect point of view, learning from that. One comms campaign that did not work out.
So, I think, if I look at it purely from a communications perspective and I'm not getting to the business side of it, I think, one comms campaign which stood out for me was the internet.org campaign, because it started with a very good purpose of making sure that Indians get low bandwidth internet on their phones and, they can get access to it. But I think it got mired in other issues and it didn't see the light of the day. But I definitely felt that there was at least a good intent at the start of it.
Okay. What's your one-time favorite preferred holiday destination?
Well, for me, if I have to look back, I would always go back home, which is Himachal. And if I had to fly out of India and if it was, if anybody would allow that today, I think it will always be Greece.
Greece. Wow. Name that one thing you learned in a big way in the last 12 months. We've all been working from home. What's that one big learning for you in the last 12, 14 months?
I think, it's been always a core value to me, which is empathy. But I think in the past 12 months, I think it's gotten much more accentuated. I think everybody's realized the importance of it, especially when we have been at a distance from each other. And I think there's a lot going in human minds. And it's always better to ask people what's going through their heads rather than assume. So, yeah, that's one learning I've had.
And the final question, describe Atul Sharma in 3 words.
I would say dependable, empathetic, and inclusive. Yeah, I think that's the way I would put myself.
Great. Thank you so much, Atul. It was lovely talking to you. Lovely learning these new things about your past 15, 20 years in the work world, which we did not know of, some of them. And I'm sure, and I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did enjoy. I enjoyed it asking you. I hope our viewers, listeners, wherever you are, have learned something new from this episode of ComSpeak. Tune in again next week to see another interesting leader in the communication space talk about their journey as well. Thank you so much and have a great day.